Safe Software is pleased to present the 2009 FME International User Conference. This session is presented by Mark Doring, a project manager and consultant with Conterra GmbH. At Conterra, Mark specializes in large migration projects and in FME server projects. He is also both an FME certified trainer and an FME certified professional.
Okay, welcome to my personal nightmare. I think it's part three. I always say that because I'm not a native speaker, so please keep this in mind if I'm running in trouble with my vocabulary. So, yeah, Safe Software decided to record all these nightmares this year. Thank you for this. Great idea. Today I would like to speak about the Inspire Fusion Center, and I think we have only 25 minutes, so I don't made an agenda, but yeah, in general we have three parts. First of all, I would like to give you a quick overview about Inspire, and afterwards I would like to show you some challenges in a project or from a project where we are used the Inspire Fusion Center in a pilot project or in a pilot. And afterwards I would like to give you a quick walkthrough to three different processes, which means the data load process, which means the configuration of the services, and afterwards of using of the Inspire network services. So, yeah, as you said, it's the last presentation, and let's make some sport. Who of you is from Europe? This is maybe interesting. Please raise your hand. Yeah, Heinz, you are from Europe, I know. So, and who of you is very familiar with the Inspire, specification parts? So these are not so many. So I'm not an Inspire expert. I'm more expert in bringing data and data models together. So I don't want to go too deep into detail of the Inspire specification, but I would like to give you some overview facts and some general facts about Inspire, just to let you know what Inspire is. Inspire is, first of all, it is a legislation process. So it is a law, and it's a binding law for every state in Europe. So what does this mean for us? There's budget to making projects and to bring spatial data infrastructures step forward. And the second thing we should know is that there are two parts, this legislation process I told, and the second thing is the technical part. And I will focus more on the technical part and not on the legislation part, because it is very boring and I think it's not so important for all of us. We are all focused on the technical things, how we can map data models and data specifications, and I think this would be good for all of us. So, yeah, Inspire requires the harmonization of relevant data themes, and these relevant data themes are called NX themes. And yeah, the harmonization is focused to use all these data in an interoperable way. So in Europe it is very hard to make a project, a cross-border project with data from many states. So we have many different languages in Europe, many different data storage systems, many different data models. We have different data transformation or projection systems. And yeah, this is a huge problem in Europe, and so the European Commission decided to harmonize all these and to bring up a European spatial data infrastructure. And the most important thing is that they are defining standards, and these are not only technical standards. These are technical standards, but in addition to these are the standard, or the result would be a standardized data model for different NX themes. So this is important to know. Another thing is the different NX themes, or you will see there are many themes, are requiring not to collect new data. So this directive from the European Commission, not force the member states to collect new data. Only if the data is existing, they have to provide this data into the Inspire network in an Inspire compliant way. This is what the, law said in this case. Yeah, as you can see, there are different annexes, three of them, and it's a kind of priorization of the different themes. And we are working now here in this data, in this annex theme one. And I will later show on an example with administrative units and protected sites. And as you can see, there are different different dates in the schedule. So until 2009, the themes or the data specification and the data model must be specified for this themes. And the other themes must be specified until 2012. And in general, it's a long-term project. So the end of the complete schedule is something about 2020, I know, I think. I'm not sure. Or 2019. So, it becomes a little bit more concrete. I would like to talk about the projects a little bit, or the pilot projects. These are two pilot projects we are doing right now. The first is with the cadastral state agency of NRW, and the second is with the land manager agency of NRW too. And as I said before, we're using the administrative units, or we would like to create data with the data model of administrative units and of protected sites, and afterwards we would like to publish these as Inspire network services. What our challenges are, or the requirements, is connecting the existing domain data models and systems to another system to bring up these network services, because the existing systems are not able to provide such services. And we are covering an extract, transform, and load process. Then the next part is the publishing process, and we are covering in our pilot project the update workflows, because the Inspire, to provide data to into the Inspire network is not only an initial process; it is a process what is done with the maintain process, and so you have to update your data, and we want to cover this update workflow in our pilot too. The current situation and challenges for our project are that the responsible data owner and provider already manage Inspire relevant data, but they manage this data in their own information and storage systems, and on top of these data and storage systems are embedded business processes, as you can imagine. So the main challenge is to keep these business processes running, and this is the focus of the data owner and of the data provider, and the focus is typically from this data owner and data provider internal, so they have not enough experience of Inspire and all these requirements from Inspire. So in our point of view, Inspire will change a lot of things. Inspire will change the data models, and the data models has to be harmonized across the organizations and across countries. Inspire will change the data of and the European geospatial infrastructure in general. And what not would be or will be changed is the business processes, because they are already in use, and the most of the business processes are related to other laws or other directives which are state internal or federal internal. And there are existing information and storage systems, and we think that they won't change too. So therefore, the main challenge is, how can we provide Inspire relevant data in a Inspire compliant way while keeping all these existing systems and all these existing processes? Yeah, and therefore we create a solution pattern. So we call it a solution pattern because it's an ongoing process. At the time we start with this project, Inspire or the Inspire specifications are on process. So we as Contera are involved in this process, but we don't know the result of the process before. So there are many players in the processes, and yeah. This is the reason why we called it a solution pattern first. So you see on the left-hand side, yeah, a distributed data storage system. And yeah, the main challenge is to transform all this information into one additional Inspire database. And then we would like to provide this Inspire database and data model via Inspire network services to the consumers or to the Inspire network. So we have the domain data models and expertise on the left-hand side from the customer, of course, because the customer always knows his data model the best. And we have the information requests from the Inspire spatial data infrastructures on the other hand. And we need something like a crystallization point in the middle, and yeah, to fuse the data and bring it together. Yeah, how does it look a little bit more in detail? So this is the existing organization, yeah, structure. So we have the GeoBasis NRW, which is the surveying agency, state surveying agency in NRW. Or North Rhine-Westphalia, and they are now providing the data to ITNRW, which is the data provider, and they are providing WFS services, for example, or ArcGIS or ArcGIS server applications to the web. And yeah, this is an existing process, and now they have the requirement to provide the Inspire services. And in our use case, we use ATKIS data. A little bit more in detail, we use NAS, which is the exchange format of ATKIS. And we designed an ETL process to fill up the Inspire data model. And in our case, the administrative units, the data seam administrative units. And afterwards, they can provide the Inspire services, network services, to the Inspire network. So in this configuration, we have a distributed data owner constellation. So a second data owner or data collector is maintain his own data storage system and provides this data to the same central data storage. It's the same data provider in this case. And they're working with different themes. So the LANOV is a land management agency. And they have an own data model. It's called OSIRIS. It's a huge and complex data model as ATKIS-2. And we designed, again, an ETL process, which is FME, which is an FME process, as you know, and yeah, filled up the protected sites. So what is important in our point of view for such a solution or a solution pattern? This is only one configuration which can be usable, and there are different ways to connect to this Inspire Fusion Center. So the first use case or the first connection could be that the data owner has an own in-house data model, an own transformation process, and then he creates for example, a shapefile, put it on a portable a disk drive or hard drive, and sends it to the data provider. There's another transformation process which imports this data into the Inspire data model. The next possible connection type is that they are running an Inspire Fusion Center or instance of the Inspire Fusion Center 2 with its own data model, and yeah, creating the same data model, but they are providing the data not directly to this institution. They are providing the data to the transformation service, and then it would be stored into the staging system or into the publishing database later on. The next thing is what we saw before, that we have a distributed data sources with distributed data seams. And this is the main reason why we call it Fusion Center, because it's possible that one seam is stored in different storage systems, and these can be different data owners or different agencies, which are totally independent from each other, but which must be fused together into one data theme later on, or annex theme. And last but not least, we have this configuration that, the Inspire Fusion Center is connected over a service, so this data owner provides a service which is not Inspire compliant, but it's a WFS service, for example, and the Inspire Fusion Center uses the WFS service and imports the data within WFS. So the question is, do we use FME server, and how don't we use FME server on the publishing side? This will I cover later on, but in this case, it depends. We can use the FME server if this is usable for the distributed situation. And this is a use case where it is a good idea in our point of view. There can be configurations where it is not necessary, because if the Fusion Center and the data owner is the same person and there's no internet between, they don't have to use the FME server, but it's more scalable. Then it depends on the decision of the customer. But in general, if we are using FME server, we will use the FME server as something like a data collector and not for the providing side. Yeah, as Heinz told before, and we saw, I think, many workshops about QA in general, we use FME technology as well to describe QA processes, because the data provider won't correct the errors in the data. He only would provide the data which is okay, and he would give back the data which is not correct and send it back to the data collector or the data owner, who can do his quality checks and then bring it again back to the Fusion Center. So this is a little bit like a loop. Oh, I have to hurry a little bit. So this is the data model from the administrative units. It's a really simple one in view of Inspire. In general, it's not so simple, but Inspire will provide huge data models, and this is one of the most simplest data models we know at the moment. So let's make a little walkthrough. I start my virtual machine and hope that it is still living. So as you can see, we have an import process, and on the left-hand side we have this NIS data in this case. We have here FFS. The only reason is that it is a lot faster if we store it in FFS but we can change it easily back to NAS. So the data model is in general from NAS. And part of our solution is the destination data model. Yeah, which means that we are describing a geodatabase model which fulfills all the requirements of Inspire. Yeah, and this process is very individual. So if you are using NAS, it's a process which we can reuse for other agencies. But in general, we know that the configuration or the systems are totally independent, and normally it is needed that the process is completely reconfigured. But the destination data model is fixed, and this is part of our solution, this destination model. So we can start this process just to see it. It's an easy one. Oh, you see this little command line. It's a little TCL script, by the way, while it is processing. It only imports a BAT file, and this BAT file clears the DB. You can look on it. It's because the Inspire model is a relational model, and we have to fill relational feature classes. And yeah, as you know, FME is not able to create relational feature classes. It only can fill them. So we have a template database and a target database where the process is running through, and we start this little Python script, and this Python script starts this BAT script and changes the database, copy the database, and it's a very easy way to deal with such two databases and with such a template database. So now the process is finished, I hope. Yeah, nearly. We can have a look on the relational feature class. This is this one. It might be interesting. So you can see it. We only fill the IDs, and later on in ArcGIS, they are build up a relation and a relational data model. So now it is usable here in ArcGIS. So as you can see, we are in Germany, and if we identify such a administrative unit, you can see that it is related to many other administrative unit levels. And NUTS regions. These are upper level. So you can see it is a very relational model. And this is a big challenge, because in Inspire it is possible to create huge data models in UML. And our work is to bring this huge data models in a physical data storage system. So you can define nearly everything in UML, but to bring this data model into a database, into a physical database, it's a big challenge. And here we see it. And now this is the second step, the configuration of the service. And as I said, it should be very easy. We would like to aim all these technical things from the user, and he just can configure and say, I would like to add a new service, administrative units, and I can open the map document, and then I can choose, and this is not part of the normal FME of the ArcGIS server. It's an extension which we provide with this solution, and then we can provide or easily define a new service type which is called Inspire View Service. Can provide the language, and so on. And then we have a new service. And the interesting thing, or the smart thing is, and this is the reason why we are choosing ArcGIS Server, we can do much more than only provide a view service. We can use the complete functionality of the ArcGIS Server. We can have rich clients, for example, for editing on the data model or for editing informations from outside. So we can use the complete ArcGIS Server technology on top. And this is the reason why we choose the ArcGIS Server for the for providing the services and not the FME Server. And yeah, last but not least, we can use this network service with a map client. In our case, I will use our own product map client. So I will load only some of them. Oh, I think let's take all. Okay, and this is the last step. Just use the services. So, okay, let's come to the end. These are some screenshots. I think they could be interesting afterwards. So the slides will be provided by Safe Software, so you can see it afterwards too, just as a reminder. So these are the results of our pilot, and we see that Inspire has left the design phase, and in our point of view, Inspire is a solution pattern, and we are looking forward to get your request, because it's a very early status of this project, and we are just developing at this time, and if you need some more information or whatever to this project, please do not hesitate to contact us. So, okay, I think we have done. Thank you for attention, and
2 minutes for a question. If you didn't get a